okay.
Pittsburgh. And
okay. Yeah, it's going now.
Perek is dealing with David HaMelech, the general. There they say that the general who understands very well the Middle East. He's not working too hard on getting all kinds of treaties. On the contrary, he's waiting until all the nations around coming to him. Because in the Middle East always, power was a very important commodity. And you get the peace agreement after you show that you deserve it. If you don't deserve it, not only you don't get a peace agreement, you get the war. And David HaMelech understood it very well. And as we see, David HaMelech sees the opportunity when the kings of the north are working hard to expand themselves and they leave their cities like Damascus. David HaMelech takes the opportunity, he arrived there, he takes over. As we said, in Pasuk Daled, David managed to take 1,700 parashim, which was the tanks of the days, 20,000 ragli. He managed by trap them, by trick them, to destroy their army, which remind me really what happened in Melchemet Shesht Hayamim. You know, it was more of a trick and understanding the field that Hashem sent us the Yeshua through. And we saw David HaMelech take all the goods of Aram and Damascus only for one purpose, to build Beit HaMikdash. He prepared the gold, he prepared the copper. And the perek from Pasuk Zayin to perek Yud Gimel is talking about how he managed to take all the goods and the commodities from the other nations and to bring it to Yerushalayim. He himself did not build the Beit HaMikdash, but Beit HaMikdash was quite an operation that required lots of money and materials. And David HaMelech started to arrange it. It was not it wasn't possible to start from nothing and to build a house like Beit HaMikdash, which was a very expensive house.
Why do we know that was all for the Beit HaMikdash? Why wasn't it just for feeding the army?
Because the Pasuk said that he brought it to Yerushalayim. I'm sure that he used it also for the army. There is no question. The excessive materials were already in Pasuk Aleph. Gam otam ikdish ha-melech David la-Hashem im ha-kesef ve-ha-zahav asher ikdish mikol ha-goyim asher kibesh. So obviously, like any other king, he used the money from the enemy to feed his own people. But the excessive money was not just to give gifts to all the warriors. He kept it for the days when it will be really needed. The interesting thing is what happened at the end of the perek. And we are right now in Pasuk. In Pasuk Yudalit. Vayasem be'edom nitzavim, bechol edom sam nitzavim. So after he conquered Edom, he does not leave them, you know, to run their life and go back. He put nitzavim. He put nitzavim were basically the people on the taxes. He used Edom as a new source of income to Medinat Israel. Vayi kol Edom avadim la'Hashem. Kol Edom avadim le'David. Vayosha Hashem et David bechol asher alach. So, yeah, what did Vayosha Hashem et David, what is the Yeshua? The Yeshua was, first of all, he was not under the threat of the nations around, which always bothered Bnei Israel, if it was once Edom or Ammon or Moab, David managed to take them over. Not only that, he made them avadim le David. וימלוך דוד על כל ישראל, פסוק תתבב, ויהי דוד עושה משפט וצדקה לכל עמו. Which is interesting. Because the Gemara already see a difference between mishpat and tzedakah. Mishpat is according to the law, to the letter of the law, mishpat. That's how you have to behave. Tzedakah is beyond it. Tzedakah is not the opposite, but it's a different thing from mishpat. So how is it possible, say the Gemara, that David was Oseh Tzedakah u'mishpat. Mishpat u'tzedakah lechol amo. So the Gemara itself bring few perushim, which are quite interesting. One said, there is mishpat which is tzedakah. And this is compromising. Pshara. We know in the Jewish law, when people are going to the Din Torah, the first thing, there is a mitzvah to offer them pshara. Before we go, you know, you have always the opportunity and the possibility that the court will decide who is right, who is wrong. But before they go into this process, the court, the Jewish court, offer the people to do a compromise, pshara. And the Gemara learned this idea from David HaMelech. Yes, he was doing tzedakah u'mishpat in one thing. How do you do tzedakah u'mishpat in one time? When they are opposite, you offer pshara. So all the people who came before David, he said, listen, I can decide, but you know what? Settle it outside the court. Let's go for pshara. And obviously, after they decide, he stamped it, and then it got the stamp of the court. So this is one pirush. The second pirush is that David was a very special king. When people came to him, he decided who is right, who is wrong. But sometimes a poor person came and he was like, had to pay, and he didn't have to pay. He didn't have the money to pay. So David said, okay, up to here is a mishpat. Now he sent him to the fund, he had the tzedakah fund. Maybe the money came also from these other nations. And he would give the person who had to pay. He said, listen, I know that you cannot pay. I don't want you to start selling your house and this and that. Take it as a tzedakah. So on one hand, David never compromised the idea of mishpat. But at the same time, the mishpat was accompanied or followed by an act of tzedakah, which is very nice. And, you know, some people say in the Gemara a very interesting idea, that doing mishpat is tzedakah by itself. Namely, if a person holds in his house something that does not belong to him, he brings upon himself lots of tzoros. So by returning something that does not belong to you to the person that owns it, you actually do a favor. The judge is doing a favor to this person. Because it's not good to have and to hold things which are not belong to us. So the Gemara has all kinds of ideas how to settle the tzedakah u'mishpat. But I think that there is another perush here. David HaMelech did tzedakah u'mishpat. Depend to whom? To the goyim around? Mishpat. To the Jewish people, tzedakah. And that was so special about the way David ran the country. With the goyim, if they, as we saw before, where the people who made tzarot to Bnei Israel, David was not hesitant and was not too nice to the people around. Mishpat, the Moabim, you know, he showed them what does it mean to mess up with his family and the Jewish people. This is Mishpat. To the Jewish people, there was tzedakah. There was a very different way to behave.
It's interesting that Pasuk uses the lashon of tzedakah as opposed to tzedek. So along the lines of the perushim,
right.
It was charity. It wasn't tzedek means righteousness.
Nachon, you're right. And it might be Vayi David Oseh Mishpat, as we saw before, to the goyim around, utzdaka lechol amo. That's the end of the pasuk. The tzedakah was lechol amo. The mishpat was for the goyim around. Yes.
It's interesting that the Micha says the same thing. Ma'ash, Yid lecha adam ma tov, ma Hashem dorish mimcha, ki ma'asot chesed, ma'asot mishpat, ahavat chesed, atzne alechid.
Atzne alechid.
Same thing.
Right.
Need a pen?
By the way, you know, if we also go to the history of David HaMelech, the idea of tzedakah, if you remember the story, for example, finding the person, the Amaleki, the Amaleki that they threw him to die in the desert, and David HaMelech feeds him. Or Shaul, that he could kill. You know, if he would kill Shaul, no one would complain. Shaul tried to kill him. You know, there is a famous halacha of Odef, Abba le'orgecha, Hashkem le'orgo. But David HaMelech always behaved with a great respect to the king, and we are going to see, by the way, in the next perik. So, this was David, a person who was very complicated, complex. On one hand, mishpat, but at the same time, he had something very kind within him that were together. This was one of the things that was so fascinating about David HaMelech, a person that on one hand had unbelievable, I would say almost cruelty towards the nations around, and at the same time, something very kind of tzedakah. Now, this brings me to something very interesting. While I'm saying it, it brings me an idea. Where David HaMelech came from? Let's think about it. David HaMelech came from a very interesting Yichus, right? He came from Lot. You know, the whole story was Lot, we just read it last week's Parsha. Lot is running away from Sodom. At nighttime, he or his daughter saw that they are the only one to stay in the world, and from there, two nations are born. From the wine in the cave, Ammon and Moab. Ammon and Moab. Moab developed to the people that the Torah said, Al dvar asher lo kidmu etchem belechem ubemayim. If you want to see cruelty, go to Ammon and Moab, two nations that were cousins of Am Israel. Am Israel coming back to his land, they don't give him anything, not lechem, not mayim, even for money. And therefore, as we say, the Torah said, on these nations, lo yavo Ammoni u'Moavi bekal Hashem. Such lack of gratitude. Such distance yourself from your own family, lo yavo amoni umoavi bekal Hashem. But there was one person who escaped this decree. Ruta Moavia, the women, were escaped from this decree. And who is the famous example? Ruta Moavia. Rut symbolizes chesed, unbelievable chesed. The whole Megillat Rut, Chazal said, why we read it on Shavuot? Because Tchilata Gmilut Chasadim Vesofa Gmilut Chasadim. The whole Megillah is an idea of Gmilut Chasadim. Shava Misde Moav, she comes back to Eretz Israel, she has a Matnotanim, at the end, Boaz married Rut. The whole idea, and the way that Ruth behaved with their mother-in-law is something very unusual. Not only between daughter-in-law and mother-in-law. The whole thing to go with an old lady, lose hope, basically the Megillah is a miracle that eventually Ruth got married, but who could believe it? So David HaMelech came from this combination. On one hand, he came from the cruelty of Sodom. Lot liked the people of Sodom because his nature was something that attracted him to Sodom. Moab come from or represent cruelty. But at the same time, the women of Moab, Ruth, represent kindness. So David HaMelech came from the source of Moab. On one side, the cruelty and the toughness of Moab, and at the same time, he acquired, or I would say this toughness was a little bit softened by someone like Ruth. By the way, the Kotzke Rebbe explained this way, why indeed Hashem chose David HaMelech to come from such a dubious dynasty, from Lot, from his daughters. And he says something very interesting, very interesting. And he says that's exactly the point. The king of Israel cannot be a yeshiva guy, you know, like soft and nice and please everyone. If you want to be a king, especially the first king that determine what are going to be the borders of Eretz Israel, to teach a great lesson to all the people around, you cannot take just like a regular Jewish guy. We are too nice. We are too nice. It's unbelievable. We are really too nice. We believe, we naive, we trust. You need to bring someone that has some cruelty, some toughness, rough. And therefore, David HaMelech had to carry these genes from Moab in order to become this tough king that controlled the Middle East. I don't know if you like it or not, but you know what? We see it. We see that the life skill that you need to be to be a leader in Eretz Israel required more than just to be nice and kind and soft. That's his explanation of the Kotzke Rebbe. Let's just go to Pasuk Tetzayin, because this is really interesting, how David built the kingdom. Ve'yoav ben Tzruya la'tzava. We are going to get the list, but it's a very important list. Yoav ben Tzruya la'tzava, Yehoshaphat ben Achilud Mazkir. He's a secretary of state. Ve'tzadok ben Achituv, ve'achimelech ben Eviatar Kohanim. So the religious leaders are Tzadok ben Achituv, Achimelech ben Eviatar. Usraya Sofer. Sofer means the person who writes all the letters to the other kings, to he apparently went to the UN of the time. Sofer means a person who writes and a very good communication skills. Ubnayahu ben Yoyada, ve'akriti ve'apleiti. Well, Chachamim really don't know what is kriti u'pleiti, but apparently they were the head of the Supreme Court. Kortim v'niflaim divrem. They were very smart people, and they could advise or to decide upon very complicated matters. And Bnayahu ben Yoyada was the head of the Supreme Court. Ubnei David kohanim ayu. Well, David came from Shevet Yehuda. His children could not be kohanim. Kohanim, Rashi said, important people. David HaMelech appointed his children also as officers, ministers that he could trust. Or, you know, nepotism always was, very acceptable. But why is it important to know this list? What does the Tanakh try to tell us about this list, about these people? If we compare it to Shaul, listen, Shaul was a king, but there was no kingdom. And it connected to the whole issue of the reason why David HaMelech did not build Beit HaMikdash. You know, if you go today to Israel, it's unbelievable. There are many movements that are talking a lot about the Bniyah of Beit HaMikdash. Before Pesach, there is like tekes of Shechitat Korban Pesach. They want to bring, that's what they say, that they try to bring awareness that soon we are going to have Beit HaMikdash rebuilt, we have to prepare for it. Kohanim can order the size of Bigdei Kehuna. There is a guy, Mendelbaum, who is making Bigdei Kehuna, all kinds of interesting things. If you learn the Perek here, why indeed Hashem told David HaMelech, you are not going to build the Beit HaMikdash? I think that the message is quite clear. We spoke about the fact that actually in Sefer Shmuel there is no reason of bloodshed. This is only in Divrei Hayamim. And by the way, David HaMelech is talking about it like in self-reflection. It's not that the Navi came to David HaMelech and say to him, oh, you were such a terrible person, or you killed so many people. David HaMelech, upon reflection, when he talked to Shlomo in Divrei Hayamim, he said, listen, I know why Hashem did not choose me to build the house. It was because I shed too much blood. But Hashem never spoke about it, and certainly, as I said, if you read Shmuel Bet, this reason does not appear at all. So what is the reason? The reason is very simple. Beit HaMikdash supposed to be, after everything is done, after Bnei Israel has their security, after the king built his house, the kingdom is well established, now Hashem says it's time to build the religious center. But you don't build the religious center before the nation is well established. And this was the message to David HaMelech. Relax, we are not there yet. We have to finish to establish the land, the army, the relationship with other nations. Then we will talk about building Beit HaMikdash. And that's exactly what happened at the time of Shlomo. International relationship were in their peak. Money and Parnassa, there was no problem. All the nations around, they never attacked Bnei Israel. On the contrary, Medinat Israel of the time, Eretz Israel of the time, Malchut Israel of the time, enjoyed fantastic relationship with Ammon and Moab and Edom, things that David HaMelech created, but Shlomo HaMelech perfected. Then it was time to build Beit HaMikdash. And what we see here is that indeed David lays a foundation to establish a kingdom. He sought not only of like controlling, like Shaul, controlling Bnei Israel, helping them in the Milchamot. This is all important. But control on your nation is an army, is mazkir, is a well-established system. What we call today manganon. Manganon means the system. You need a system, and David HaMelech understood it very well, which is quite amazing. Because many people who are great generals, they don't understand how to build a system. They are very good in thinking ahead, all kind of tricks, fundamentals. But to run a nation, you need very different skills, and many generals actually lack these skills. David HaMelech knew that if he want to build a kingdom, he needs to have this list. Special people for the religious issues, special people for the Kriti and the Pliti, the Supreme Court or the court system, special people, Mazkir, Secretary of State. That's how a real state looks like. David HaMelech understood it, and that's what Perek Chet is telling us about.
Then why couldn't he build it after Perek Chet?
I'm sorry?
Why couldn't he build it after Perek Chet?
You're right. Actually, it's very possible. Perek Chet, in a way, as we are going to see, and Perek Tet, in a way, David HaMelech got to the highest point. From there on, it's winter time, we are going to ski down. From Perek Yud, troubles, 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 as we are going to see. And if not these troubles, you might be right. Maybe David was the person who will build Beit HaMikdash. But somehow, as I said, from Perek Tet and on, things get complicated. They are not, the trend is not up, the trend is actually down, until the days of Shlomo HaMelech, but we have enough time. I don't want to spoil the whole Shmuel bit. In Perek Tet, and I hope you have it, yes, everyone. I think we have one up here. Right. I also need maybe the translation. With all his great achievements, David is the person of tzedakah u'mishpat on the small scale as well. You know, sometimes people are coming to leadership positions, they forget all their past, not David HaMelech. Vayomer David, hachi yesh od asher notar lebeit Shaul ve'esei mo chesed ba'avur Yonatan. Interesting. David HaMelech is looking for someone from the house of Shaul because he remembers his treaty and covenant with Yonatan. I'm sure you remember the people who learned together Sefer Shmuel Aleph. Yonatan in Perek Chaf realizes that David is going to be the next king. And he asks David to do with him and his family Brit covenant of Chesed. Yonatan say to David in Perek Chaf, Velo imodeni chai. Even if I will not be alive, ולא תעשה עמדי חסד השם. Please don't forget to do with me חסד השם. ולא תחרית את חסדך מעם ביתי עד עולם. So Yonatan, who knows that David is going to be the king, ask David to remember him and to do חסד with his family. And David is looking now for the opportunity to pay his commitment and promise to Yonatan. Listen, the house of Shaul was destroyed. Shaul died. His children died. We learn in Perek Dalet that there was one little child who, when they ran away, she dropped him and he was Necher Raglaim. And apparently they disappeared completely from the scene. The house of Shaul disappeared from the scene. And David at this point felt that he cannot ignore his promise to Yonatan, his friend, not only friend, a person who actually tried everything in order to change the heart of his father. It did not work. As we mentioned many, many times, Yonatan could not leave his father. Eventually he sided with his father. But David remembered very well that Yonatan tried hard to save the life of David. Remember when Shaul wanted to kill him, he did the whole thing with the arrows and told him that if my father will insist to kill you, I will find a way to communicate it to him, to you, and indeed he saved his life. So, the Tanakh is telling us, Ulebeit Shaul, Eved u'shmo tziva. So Beit Shaul was not exist anymore. But, you know, it was an important family of Binyamin. And there was one person who was a servant in the house of Shaul, and he still apparently managed the properties, the fields of the family of Shaul. And his name was Tziba. Vayikreu lo el David. So once David was looking to see if there is anyone that he can treat properly from the house of Shaul, the only one to give him an accurate information was this Eved Tziba. Vayomer ha-melech eilav, ha-ata Tziba, I heard that there is a person Tziba who is on charge of the property of Shaul, is it you? Vayomer avdecha, it's me. I'm your servant. Which apparently was the way that people refer to their king. Like, the king talk to you, you say, yes, sir. Or like, ani avdecha, ani avdecha. I'm your slave or servant. Vayomer ha-melech, ha-efes od ish le-beit Shaul, tell me. I know that you are managing the property of Shaul. What about these children? Does he have any family anymore? Ve'esei mo chesed. Chesed Elohim. Vayomer tziba el ha-melech od ben Yonatan. Neche raglan. Actually, yes. Yonatan has a son, which is neche raglan. He can't walk. How do you analyze this pasuk? What Yonatan, how do you see the answer that Tziba gives David?
He mentioned Yonatan,
that's it's very true. Okay, you can say it's a fact.
He's a cripple, and he's not a threat to them.
Right, right. David never asked him, tell me, can he go to the army? Can he run the marathon for me? Like, why did he say, Vehu necher raglaim? David asked him, does he have a child? Answer him, yes, he has a child. When David HaMelech will ask you, how is he doing? Tell him that he's crippled. What? Why he said, Od ben Yonatan, necher raglaim? How do you understand it?
Because he may be suspicious that David wants to find out if there's somebody out there and he'll get rid of him if he's a threat.
So the Radak indeed explained it, that Tziva was very loyal to the house of Shaul. And he was afraid, why the king now is interested to know if there is any survivor to Beit Shaul? So Tziva thought, say the Radak, according to the first Perush, that David HaMelech want to get rid of him. Because he's afraid that one day he will come back and will say, listen, I'm back. I'm the son of Shaul the king, and Tziva was suspicious. Like, why? He suspected David. Why are you asking about him? And therefore he said, yes, he had a son, but you have nothing to worry about. He's not going to compete with you. He's crippled. Yes.
Why did he feel threatened? Because the king says, say mo chesed. He says, I want to know if there's anybody that I can do. So why should he do that?
It's very interesting, because that's exactly the question of the Ralbag and other Mefarshim. Why should you be suspicious if David said, I want to pay him like a favor for what his father did for me? And we are going to see from the development of the Perek that you're right. Tziva was not like a good neshama that tried to save the life of Yonatan. We are going to see that it's quite different. Now, let's think about the situation that we have here. Clearly, David HaMelech did not know anything about this son of Yonatan. How is that possible? That he didn't know that he has a son? Well, let's read the next pasuk. Vayomer lo ha-melech, eifu? this is like the grandson of the previous king. You know, people like him does not disappear. Vayomer tziva el ha-melech, inehu beit machir ben amiel, he's in the house of machir ben amiel, belo davar. Belo davar, the Mefarshim say there was a place that mentioned in Sefer Yoshua, it calls Ladavar. Ladavar, over there, it's not Lodavar, but Ladavar is a city by this name, in the, where is Ramat HaGolan of today? Ramat HaGolan, the lower part of Ramat HaGolan. What is strange about it? So Tziva is telling him, when David asked, where is he? He said, he's with Beit Machir Ben Amiel, in this remote place in Ramat HaGolan. Lo davar. Yes?
Maybe the contradiction. First, he's afraid to, he's saying, you know, he says he's crippled, you don't have to worry about him. Then he tells him exactly where he is. I mean, if he's afraid, why does he tell him exactly
okay,
where
listen,
he is?
You cannot mess up with David, especially after you read the previous parak and you see that David knew how to treat his enemies chad v'chalak, like he did not waste too much time. So obviously he had to answer him. But we will talk about like the way he answers him. So we have a person who is the chief servant of the house of Shaul, that apparently there was estate and money that Shaul left behind. He was a king after all. And where is his son? Where is a real person that belongs to the family? Where is he? Somewhere, I don't know, like in Ramat HaGolan. Let me tell you today, you know, the people in Ramat HaGolan are very nice people, but normally, except of Ben Gurion who goes to Sde Boker, the people are in Tel Aviv, in Yerushalayim, in the main cities. Who is going to Ramat HaGolan?
He's in hiding.
He might be in hiding, maybe. Maybe.
Maybe that's why he didn't know about him, because he didn't want people to know that he had a son who was not able to, not able body. So he hid him somewhere out of the main area.
Okay. But let me ask you a question. This tziva, from the discussion, from the question and answer to David, do you get any impression about this tziva, what kind of guy he was? Is he very cooperative with David? Let me tell you something. If someone would call you and ask about someone that is close to you, wouldn't you give him like the details and tell him, okay, he's here, he's there, this is his history? Everything David has to milk the answers from Tziva. Tziva is not very cooperative. And there is something very strange here, I must say. The Nachala of Binyamin, where Shaul came from, is not far away from Yerushalayim. The city of Ladavar is in Ramat HaGolan. What the grandson of Shaul is doing in a place which is not basically even his Nachala, it's not belong to Shevet Binyamin. Shevet Binyamin is Ramallah, Psagot, all this area which is north of Yerushalayim. Why is the son of Yonatan, a person from Binyamin, why is he in Rosh Pina, in this area? Why?
But wouldn't it also make sense that when the Metapelet ran with him, she was trying to save whoever was left from Beit Shaul to save him, so she takes him to a refuge far, far away so that he will be safe. I mean, I realize, I think that from your side, you're trying to say that possibly that Tziva has an agenda here, and he wants to be like the Yoresh of Beit Shaul. But in Tzad Sheni, it's possible that Yonatan's, the Mitapelet, wanted to save the child and the Mishpacha.
I completely agree with you. I don't think that we contradict each other. The story started with a story that the Nani, the Omenet of Mephibosheth, this person, she tried to save his life, because normally, as we say many, many times, kings, the new kings, got rid of the previous dynasty of the previous king. So she tried to help him. But it's quite clear, after a while, that David HaMelech had a very different agenda. David HaMelech, you know, he is not looking for revenge, he's not looking to kill people, but certainly for a few years, they are not coming back to Jerusalem. And David, to the point that David is not even sure that anyone from the house of Shaul still exists.
Maybe yes? Siva really was holding out to somehow restore the house of Shaul, or some, you know, maybe with other allies in that area. Somehow he didn't have a chance to do it in Binyamin. It was too close to David. Somehow to depose, to take back power. So more chance there.
Well, the story here is quite simple, and we are going to see how it's developed. David HaMelech understood that he's up to a very nasty development here. Tziva. And you know, it happened until this very day. People who are dependent. Sometimes there will be people who will take away their money and their estate. I would say that we read too many stories like this. Of old people, they are dependent on someone who will find a way to change the will and do all kinds of things. And David HaMelech says that maybe this is a case here too. There was a king. The only survivor is someone who cannot take care over himself. So Tziba is very smart. He said, stay there in Ramat Golan. We don't need you here. Meanwhile, Shaul left a state in Binyamin. He will take over it. He will sell the fruits, he will sell the tvuah. It's actually quite apparently a nice estate. And David understands what's going on here. This Tziba actually took over the property of Shaul HaMelech himself. Vayishlach HaMelech David vayikachehu. Mibeit Machir ben Amiel milo davar. You see, Tziva apparently does not have any connection with him. Maybe he paid this person in Shevet Gad and say, you take care over him. I don't want him here around. That's it. I'm the new person who took over the property of Shaul. Vayavo Mephiboshet ben Yonatan ben Shaul. By the way, here is the first time that we hear his name. Because the way Tziva presented him to David was, he's the son of Yonatan and he's crippled. Does not even give him the respect to say his name is Mephibosheth. He's no one. No name, nothing. He's crippled on top of everything. Tziva himself saw him as a person with no name, with no personality, but he's like belong to the house of Shaul. He took over. He should stay there in Lo Davar. And the name, I think, was changed a little bit because Lo Davar means is basically nothing. What is Lo Davar in Hebrew? Lo Davar, nothing. Yeah. He's nothing. He lives in nothing. Gornished. He lives in Gornished. Vayavo Mephiboshet ben Yonatan ben Shaul el David. Now the Pasuk give him importance. The son of Yonatan, the grandson of Shaul. ויפול על פניו וישתחו. ויאמר דוד מפיבושת, ויאמר הנה עבדך. And you write, do you see the fear of Mephibosheth? The Tanakh is actually recording. You know, sometimes there is like in a, I like these examples from the classroom because it's very real. There are students with no self-esteem whatsoever. You tell them, David, say, well, what happened? Like, it looks like the same like here. Like he said, Mephibosheth. In Avdecha. Wait a second. Let the king to finish what he wants to say. But he was so terrified that something is going to happen. So the moment David just said Mephibosheth, he wanted to say Mephibosheth, Shalom Aleichem, or something like this. He jumped like, yes, Ani Avdecha. Vayomer lo David, al tira. David, so right away, relax. I don't want to do anything bad to you. כי עשו אעשה עמך חסד בעבור יונתן אביך. And few things are going to follow. והשיבותי לך את כל שדה שאול אביך. I'm going to return all the estate of Shaul to you. ואתה תאכל לחם על שולחני תמיד. And on top of it, you are going to become someone who always in the palace. אוכל לחם על שולחני תמיד means that you are going to live in the palace. He brought him from nowhere, לא דבר, to the center of Jerusalem. Apparently gave him few rooms in his palace, and he was there. Now, והשיבותי לך את כל שדה שאול אביך, what does that mean? From who is going to return it? Return it from whom?
Ziva.
From Ziva. The Radak himself said that maybe all the fields went to David because this was the minag, that one king take over all the property of the previous king. But it's hard to believe because, remember, it was a tribal system. And it's hard to believe that David took the tribal estate of Binyamin. It much more makes sense, especially when we see how Tziva tried to minimize the whole thing with Mephibosheth, that he tried to tell him, listen, I'm going to take it from Tziva and to give it to you. And on top of it, תאכל לחם על שולחני תמיד. And when I read the issue with the lechem, I thought about the following idea. Why he awarded him to eat on his table. Do you remember what was the case where Yonatan actually stood against his father and actually his father wanted to hit him? Remember when it happened?
On Rosh Chodesh, he was having a seuda.
A seuda, exactly. The place where Yonatan was moser nefesh for David happened around the table of Shaul HaMelech. And in the seuda, when Shaul asked, where is David? And Yonatan told him that he left to his family and he was very upset with him. This was the moment that David knew to appreciate. He said, your father, in the Seuda, when he ate the food, he cared about me so much, so you are going now, from now on, to be on my table all the time, which is quite incredible. וישתחו ויאמר מעבדך, who am I? כי פנית אל הכלב המת אשר כמוני. I'm a dead dog, like, which means nothing, I'm nothing. And obviously, again, if we would have a Tanakh here, do you remember what David told Shaul when he found him? Remember the story when Shaul is on the top of one hill and David on the other one. What David is asking Shaul, so I recorded it for you. He said to him, אחרי מי יצא מלך ישראל? What a shame. You are chasing me. The king of Israel is chasing me, and how he described himself? אחרי מי אתה רודף? אחרי כלב מת, a dead dog, אחרי פרוש, like a bed bug. So see how beautiful the Tanakh is taking the same expression that David told Shaul, you run after me. And now the grandson of Shaul uses the same phrase to highlight the greatness of David, who taking care over someone that basically no one would complain if he wouldn't, and the way Shaul treated him. And he was his son-in-law, by the way. The Tanakh, by using the word, the expression Kelev Met, and put it in the mouth of Mephibosheth now, just give us a contrast, a very strong one, between the behaviors of David and the behaviors of Shaul. Vayikra melech el tziva na'ar Shaul vayomer elav. I have good news for you, I mean bad news. Kol asher haya leShaul ולכל ביתו נתתי לבן אדונך. Today, take all your family, everything that you have, because it does not belong to you anymore. It's going to be, again, the estate of the family of Shaul. ועבדת לו את האדמה. You are going now to be his עבד. Ata ubanecha va'avadecha. You, your children, and your servants. And you are going to see in a second that Tziva built the whole empire on the estate of Shaul. Ve'aya leven adonecha lechem ve'achalo. Umefiboshet ben adonecha yuchal tamid lechem al shulchani. You should know, you should treat him now with respect. He's eating on my table now. And we are going to discuss the significance of it. Uletziva, 15 banim ve'esrim abadim. He was not just like, you know, himself and his wife and two children. He had 15 children. He had to feed all of them. And you can understand what was his motivation to take all the estate of Shaul. And the Srim Abadim, so the guy built an empire basically, and David HaMelech said, forget about it. Everything that you hold, go back to Mephibosheth and treat him with respect from now on. Vayomer tziva el HaMelech, kechol asher yetzave Adoni HaMelech et avdo, ken yase avdecha. Well, he had no choice, and he is telling the king that obviously that's what he's going to do. Umefiboshet ochel al shulchani keachad mibnei hamelech. So there are two perushim. What is the end of the pasuk? Rashi said that the second part, Mefiboshet ochel al shulchani, Mefiboshet will eat with me, is David HaMelech saying. So Tziva answered the king, yes, I accept it, I will be your slave and his slave, I'm going to do everything that you told me to do. And then David said, Umefiboshet ochel al shulchani keechad mibnei HaMelech. The Radak understand it a little bit different, and he said that although I understand from what you said that he will not need me to feed him because he's going to eat from you, but nevertheless, I'm going to treat him and everything that the estate will produce, I'm going to give to him. Okay. We are going to see later who was this Tziva. He was not a simple person. And he will be involved in the life of David later on in a way that we will draw the connection between this story to the other two stories later. And you are going to see that this Tziva was a very sophisticated and bad man. We are going to see it later. Ule Mefiboshet ben Katan ushmo Micha. So this story is happening quite later. Remember that in Perek Daled, when the Omenet, the nanny, dropped him and he became crippled, he was 5 years old. Now, if he had now a little child, okay, they did not marry then when they were in their 20s, they married when they were teens, but we are talking about few good years, maybe anything between 13 to 20 years. And his family of Mephibosheth and his son, which is basically the people that built the dynasty of Shaul. V'chol moshav beit tziva avadim leMephibosheth. You see what happened here? From a person who lived in Ramat HaGolan, in nowhere, he becomes a person that sit in the palace. David HaMelech bring him to the palace. Tziva, instead of managing him, now Mephibosheth manage Tziva. And we can see how much David took care personally on changing the situation. And if we expected that the king, who really had very bad relationships with the house of Shaul, we see exactly the opposite, how David remembered his promise to Jonathan and tried to do the most of it. If you remember, and that's what I want to connect it to what I said before, when Jonathan understood that David is going to be the king, he told David, you are going to be the king, I'm going to be the viceroy. I'm going to be the Mishneh LaMelech. That's how he visioned the change. He thought that he himself is not going to be the king. It was quite clear to him. But he saw that the fact that Hashem chose Shaul and his family mean that he is going to be part of Malchut Israel in a different capacity. And David HaMelech actually keep it. The moment you bring a person to the palace, in a way, he's a Mishneh LaMelech. We all know how royal feasts look like. You bring the diplomats, you bring the ambassador, you bring other people from other nations to eat with you. And Mephibosheth from this moment on is on Shulchan HaMelech. Everyone can see him, everyone can see how close he is to David, and even if he is not like entitled Mishneh LaMelech, but the fact that he's sitting there in the Armon and David respect him and he always eat with him, and if people came again and again to talk to David, they always saw Mephibosheth over there. In a way, it was a fulfillment of the request of Yonatan. He became, in a way, a Mishneh LaMelech. And you know, the incredible thing is, you think about it. When you invite a person, especially in this day, today, Baruch Hashem, we are in a very different society, a crippled person, completely independent, and you bring him to the table, I can assure you 100% that from time to time, David HaMelech served him. Actually, Chazal said that this Mephibosheth was a great scholar. And when people came to David, he always turned questions to Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth, what do you say about this? What do you say about that? And he gave him such respect in front of other people that he was really considered Mephibosheth as part of the closest people to David. So from the person, from Shaul, his grandfather, who tried to kill David, David is showing us who he was. A person who took full care on a person who was completely dependent, completely unable to take care over his own life. And David shows us in this parak what kind of a great person and a leader, not only for the nation, but for individuals, for your friends. Because that's what happened in politics. You know, the friends are just a way to bring you to the next position. And you forget them many times right after. David HaMelech showed us something very different. He was not a politician. Yonatan helped him. Okay, now you forget about him because he doesn't need him anymore. On the contrary, by David, it's not about the politics. It's about being the king of Israel. And next week, Be'ezras Hashem, we are going to see how things start to change. And the interesting thing is, we are going to see how this episode, which is not significant by itself, prepare us to some unpleasant events that are going to take place in the life of David HaMelech later on. So, Laila Tov, thank you very much. And
how does the parak end?
Yes.
Repeating that he's still late. The last parak, he's still late in politics.
Right. You're right.